Hello, I'm Matt. I have a crazy idea of building my own electric car. Of course, I won't be building it from ground zero. I will be buying one of the existing cars and converting it to electric. I started my work from buying Toyota Prius inverter and the gearbox and converting it to electric drivetrain using open inverter board. However, now I've got this under my belt, I want to go level up and get more powerful motor. My initial plan was to go for the Lexus GS450H gearbox and inverter. To control Lexus inverter, I ordered Zombie Verter VCU. But this was disrupted by unexpected eBay find of the cheap Tesla Model S front drive motor. Will this make Zombie Verter VCU redundant? No, I've decided to finish the board and test it as it will help with controlling all other aspects of the vehicle. And I can interface it to the open inverter board that will be controlling the Tesla motor. I received this board with some of the components missing and I have to solder them in to be able to use the board. As the shipment from Mauser arrived a while ago, it's time to get crafty with some soldering. I've got all my components ready and just waiting to be unpacked. And because I like to keep things organized, I'm starting with the smaller ICs. After all, it's easier to hit the little guy first before tackling the big boys. I follow my trusty soldering technique, which is basically just a lot of flux and gentle touch with my soldering iron. These SOEC packages are a breeze to work with, plenty of space between the legs for me to show off my soldering skills. Just a quick slide and job done. And finally, it's time for the big guns, the MOSFET transistors. I follow the same principle, but it just need a little bit extra TLC, since these guys have a larger tap at the back. I have to heat it up for a bit longer to make sure the solder flows through properly. So there you go, folks, another successful soldering complete. Before I could power up the zombie board for the first time, I needed to make sure that the current supply is limited. This has to be done so I won't damage the board too badly. Just a minor smoke could occur. I settled on limiting current to 200 milliamp in the end. Now I just need to hook up the power supply and will it work? Will it work? Press the power button and we got a light. At least that means that 3.3 volts is working. Just to finish off the first power on test, I needed to measure all supply voltages. The best place to measure those voltages would be tantalum capacitors C23 and C13. I kind of know that 3.3 volt is working because of the fact that LED was lit when I powered the board. I could guess that 5 volts is working too, as 3.3 volt is derived from 5 volt supply. But let's just measure it for fun. I know I have a weird sense of fun, but just to be sure, I had to check it. Okay, now is the time to breathe in some life into our zombie board. To program it, I will use my trusty ST-Link programmer dongle. On the board, I soldered 3-pin connector, clock, data and ground. Just get those connected and plug into USB port of my laptop. I need to power the board and it will be ready for programming. I downloaded the latest firmware, which happens to be 1.11a at the time of publishing this video. We will need a hex file, but I got the bin just as well. First, I will connect ST-Link programmer and open a bootloader hex file. Now we could get programming bootloader. Bootload the program and verify. Okay, this is done now. I could move on to programming the actual VCU software. Open VCU hex file and program and verify. Okay, this is also done. If programming has gone correctly, the second LED on the board will start flashing. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this episode. The next one coming up will reveal if I have received the Tesla motor. And if you did enjoy this one, please like, please subscribe if you'd like to follow the series of this build and find out what happens next.